is how most of us spend our time whenever we visit a provincial park. Here in British Columbia, we have an impressive total of 397 to choose from, in which to camp, fish, hike, or just lie on the beach. There's no doubt that recreation is the main reason we visit our park areas. But while we enjoy making the woods our temporary home, many come to observe those for which our parks are a home year-round. And that, of course, is the wildlife. It isn't always so easy to find, but if you look close enough and in the right places, you'll discover many types of wildlife in and around our park areas, no matter what their size. For wildlife to thrive, though, their habitat must be able to support them. And while provincial parks provide an excellent opportunity for animal habitat, simply sectioning off an area and calling it a park does not guarantee a healthy and abundant wildlife population. Much support is often needed to ensure the land, and in turn the wildlife, is preserved. On this edition of Probe, we'll be taking a look at some of the wildlife management projects presently underway in many of our parks. We'll see what insight and information is gained towards maintaining and enhancing wildlife, parks, and people. For many of us, contact with wildlife is a rarity. It's only when we venture away from the hustle and bustle of our city streets to the comparative quiet of our wilderness areas that we tune into the other creatures in nature. Sometimes we find the chance to make real contact. For those who do, it provides a new experience and an insight towards ourselves and the conservation of our world. 1987 marks the 100th anniversary of wildlife conservation in North America. And it was here in Canada where the very first wildlife sanctuary was established. Last Mountain Lake, near Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, was established as a sanctuary for migratory birds back in 1887. But along with the many varieties of ducks, swallows, and even pelicans, the site has become home to many ground-based forms of wildlife as well. Here in British Columbia, wildlife conservation is prominent in many regions. And in particular, it is the provincial park system that entertains much of this activity. In our own Thompson-Nicola district, several of the parks are continually engaged in wildlife management programs, a fact that seems only natural, considering the habitat they provide and the purpose for which parks exist.
BC Parks, with respect to managing wildlife, plays two roles. The first mandate, of course, is to provide recreational opportunities for our users of BC and visitors from elsewhere, and that's by providing provincial campgrounds and day use areas. And our second mandate is to preserve and conserve natural areas for wildlife, and by that we mean the not only preserving the land base, but also ensuring that the population levels are adequate and that their habitat requirements are met. For this year, There's probably a dozen major projects going on with respect to wildlife management in British Columbia parks, and there's dozens and dozens of smaller type projects going on as well.
There are many examples of wildlife in BC that come to mind, but perhaps the one most thought of and most feared is this fellow, Ursus americanus, the black bear. He is prevalent throughout the province, but whether he is as fearsome as some people say he is, well, that's debatable. Here at Monck Provincial Park, just north of Nicola, BC, that very debate is being examined. Naturalist Bob Davis, along with facilities from the park, leads a program designed to inform the public about bears and other animals in the wild.
So this guy is a grizzly bear. Now, the other one is called Ursus arctos middendorf.
How often do you do talks of this nature?
Well, really, a talk like this would go just about any time anybody wanted me to give one. I think it's important that somebody be available for a talk like this. We had a lot of fun today, and it was probably something that that they would pick up more easily than they would in a classroom. Boy Scouts took advantage of me last year, and a couple of school groups. So it goes really whenever anybody wants me.
What is the first thing that people are concerned about when it comes to bears?
Well, that's an interesting question, because it was one of the questions that I was asked probably the most in the last 2 years that I've been a naturalist at Monck Park, and that was, are there bears around here? Almost word for word verbatim, you could tell by the people that they were going to ask that question, and really it's a quite a simple answer when you give it, is there is no place in British Columbia that you can go without having bears around you, especially in a camping environment. And they didn't realize that the bears are everywhere.
Bears indeed can be found everywhere in BC. Sometimes, though, their search for food can bring them to places they aren't always wanted, as was the case during the hot, dry summer of 1987, which saw several bears venture right within the city limits of Kamloops. Usually, though, it is the wilderness campgrounds of our parks where bears are noticed and occasionally become a nuisance. Dave, are bears a real concern for campers?
No, not generally. Of course, in a wilderness park like Wells Gray, we've got lots of bears. But by and large, most of them dislike people and they stay in the woods.
So when does a bear become a problem?
Bears become problems when they get into situations which could endanger people, particularly in the campgrounds. A bear might wander into a campground and discover somebody's picnic camper lying on the table, not put away as it should be, and just find that he likes the same things that people like, and he may come back again and again and again. We also have bears that get into garbage. If we find continued problems with bears, you know, then we would assume that that bear is liable to be around the campground for a while, and we would put the trap in place for him. We find a particular spot that seems a regular travel route for the bear, and we set the trap up in there. It's got signs, as you see, to keep people out. Mm-hmm. The spring-loaded door is strong enough to certainly break fingers, so we don't want any people playing in there. And we bait the trap and leave it there. And it's checked regularly to ensure that if we do catch a bear, he doesn't stay in there for more than a few hours. The bait is hung from this wire here underneath the trip switch. Mm-hmm. When the bear enters the back of the trap, he tugs at the bait, pulls the tripwire, closes the door. 3 or 4 hours later, when park staff next come on shift to check that trap, there he is, and he gets towed away.
And he can't get out?
No, he can't. Once you're in there, you cannot get out. So people shouldn't get in there either.
One of the largest parks in the province logically entertains some of the larger wildlife projects. The over 500,000 hectares, which make up the beautiful and rugged Wells Gray Provincial Park, plays home to a vast array of wildlife. One of the most notable examples, and possibly most difficult to find, is the caribou. It is this magnificent animal for which a most energetic project has been created. A crew of park officials and biologists are here to comb the area by helicopter. With a sophisticated electronic device known as a telemeter, they scan for certain radio frequencies from deep within the forested valleys and alpine areas, intently watching the ground below and listening for the signal that will lead them to the caribou. It was about a year and a half ago when a number of female caribou were caught and fitted with radio collars. Since then, they've been tracked and checked up on at certain intervals in the year, primarily to count their calves. But the project goes much further than simply discovering calf production and survival rates.
There's basically two major types of information we're trying to get from these caribou. One is by following them around the radio-collared animals, the basic movement patterns, migration patterns, type of habitat that they use, so we can identify the important habitats that these caribou use. The second part of the project is more related to population dynamics, trying to understand the status of the population, how well they're doing, and what are the important limiting factors. So calf survival is an obvious part of that. In addition to that, we're also looking at the adult survival rate, why adults die, and also every winter we can go out and count the population to see if the population is increasing or decreasing.
This project is one of the largest of all wildlife management operations in the province. It began, though, as a result from certain concerns held by park officials. For, in an area adjacent to Wells Gray, known as the Quesnel Highlands, a decline of almost 30% was noticed in the caribou population there. It was thought that logging in the area might be the reason for the decline, but in fact, it turned out to be of a more natural cause, that being heavy predation by wolves. This was an example where simply preserving the land in the park did not necessarily protect the caribou, and so the project to track and count the caribou in Wells Gray was arranged. Fortunately, the numbers here have been encouraging.
The Wells Gray Park population seems to be doing much, much better. The mortality rate of adults is lower, and also they have good calf survival. Like, simply that last calf count we did here in October, still 40% of the adult females still have their calves surviving. The Quesnel Highlands, the topography isn't nearly as rugged. Wells Gray Park, most of those caribou are migrating into very, very rugged terrain. They're well up above tree line, very up with the glaciers, many of them. And basically they're leaving the wolves behind, and I think that's resulting in a much lower predation rate.
Elsewhere in the park, other wildlife projects are taking place, though not so adventurous as calf count. One in particular deals with this tender bit of vegetation, clover. In some areas, there's been a higher yield of clover along forest trails, and there are a couple of good reasons for it.
Actually, what we've done here, Annette, is we have planted a lot of clover in with our grass that we usually plant in here. There's two reasons for that. The first one being that by putting in another species, such as the grasses and the clovers, it makes it so that the thimbleberries and all the other brushes that we're looking at, it takes longer for them to establish themselves, which means that we don't have to maintain the trail quite as much, and it can be used for horse traffic or whatever. The second thing is it allows the grouse actually to get an additional food source. It makes it easier for them. They prefer this clover, and everybody seems to do quite all right because of that.
Did you notice a decline in grouse that would prompt you to plant clover?
Actually, I don't know that we really noticed a decline. We just saw it as an opportunity to try something out to encourage or enhance the population that already existed. To date, we see a few more grouse than we usually do. Our staff are mentioning there's families of grouse all along the road in the evenings, and I think we do see some result from it.
They say seeing is believing, and in a span of 15 minutes or so, we ourselves saw as many as 10 grouse feeding along this particular trail, almost oblivious to our camera. It was plain to see that here, at least, there has been a noticeable result, and all from the simplest of projects. In another corner of Wells Gray, another project initiated by park officials is evident. This time, it was as simple as putting up these birdhouses. Although the swallows for which these homes were built have long since gone for the season, it's hoped they will return again next summer to carry out an important function for those campers who frequent the area.
These are nailed onto a lot of trees over at Mahood Campground on Mahood Lake. And the intention is to control mosquitoes with the birds that live in here.
How effective are swallows for decreasing the mosquito or fly population?
Swallows are voracious insect eaters. They eat hundreds of mosquitoes a day. And if we have, say, 75 nest boxes, and we get every one of them occupied by two swallows with a nest full of three or four eggs, then hopefully they will eat millions and millions of mosquitoes over the course of the summer.
Almost or as effective as spraying?
I think it's probably not as effective as spraying, but swallows do not adversely affect anybody else, except perhaps the campers who don't like the little white spots in their picnic tables.
And so, a symbiotic relationship has been created between man and bird, each helping the other for a more desirable habitat. Our journey next takes us to the Adams River area near Shuswap Provincial Park. Noted most for the world-famous runs of sockeye salmon during the autumn months, the Adams River also is involved in a particular wildlife project. In this case, it's rainbow trout, which are of special interest. Today, the river mouth is literally jammed with anglers, all hoping to latch on to one of the many rainbow which are feeding on the sockeye eggs. For Brian Hebden, though, who works for the Ministry of the Environment, his task is not only to catch, but tag as many of the rainbow as possible. It's all part of a project to gather information about the rainbow in this area. After capture, each fish is first weighed. Measurements are then taken, as well as a few scale samples to determine the fish's age. All of this is recorded on a special card. The fish then is tagged with a marker that displays an identity number. This will alert an angler if ever the fish is caught again, so that he may pass certain details about the catch to the ministry. Lastly, the fish is then returned to the water, where it recovers and swims away.
Well, the scale samples in particular will give us an indication of the life histories of the individual fish, and it will also give us an age structure of the population of rainbow trout and the other species that we're collecting scales on here, such as Dolly Varden. It'll also give us an indication of growth. In some instances, we'll be able to compare this and see whether or not these fish are rearing in the lake versus, say, the streams, for example. The tagging information will give us information on movements of fish in the lake and in the streams. Hopefully, we'll see them spawning in the spring, and we'll be able to tell whether or not some of these fish that we've tagged this fall and this spring earlier this year will in fact show up in the stream spawning next year. So we'll be able to do some identification through that. The study itself is in a preliminary phase. And so right now, basically all we're doing is some bioreconnaissance work in order to get a handle on the fish population in general.
Just west of Clinton, BC, is an area known as the Big Bar Wetlands. This particular spot is Otter Marsh. During better times, this site is an important nesting and stopping point for a variety of waterfowl. But now, the supply of water is depleted. The ground is cracked and dried, but fortunately, not for long. This marsh, along with three others in the area, is getting a facelift. In each case, an earth dam is being constructed at the mouth. And it's no small task to accomplish. Tons of dirt must be moved, shaped, and packed down. Forms, too, must be put in for the controls that will eventually govern the flow of water.
Well, we wanted to secure the wetlands, and we wanted to enhance them. We felt that there was some capability with having a water control structure on these marshes to be able to enhance them as well. What you do is you have a legal structure there. It's licensed by the provincial government. When you have a control, you can sort of open up the tap effectively and let some water through and still keep some back. With regard to enhancement, we're concerned with providing good interspersion of cover and water, the sort of two ends of a scale. There's lots of cover so choked that the birds can't get among it. It's very dense and packed. Then there's so open that there's nowhere to hide when a predator comes along and nowhere to escape to. nowhere to nest. So when you manage the water levels, you have some capability of enhancing, increasing or reducing cover. That's one thing. You also have an ability to increase the productivity of that marsh in terms of its invertebrates and of its aquatic plants, which are the food for waterfowl. Those are the two primary ways in which water control enhances a marsh.
In the case of Otter Marsh, it's been a combined effort from BC Parks and Ducks Unlimited. However, the parks do more than just cooperate. To take full advantage of the project, an interpretive trail has been built along Big Bar Lake, all the way to the wetland area. In future, this will allow visitors to the area a first-hand view of the waterfowl in the secured natural habitat, which is vital to their productivity and survival. As well as organizations such as Ducks Unlimited, there are individuals who work on a cooperative basis with BC Parks. Chris Harris is a senior park naturalist, but spends much of his time in the park capturing and banding birds. Actually trying to catch an animal as small as a bird is a lot more difficult than it sounds. Experience along with some special equipment is needed. This is a mist net, a very fine mesh that looks much like a badminton net when set up. A location is selected amid bushes from which birds fly to and from. As long as the wind doesn't blow too hard and the sun doesn't give the net away, hopefully a bird will fly into the near invisible mesh. Once a bird is caught, the real work begins. Chris will then obtain as much information as he can about the bird, including its weight, size, whether it's male or female, which isn't always so easy. And last but not least, a metal band is attached to its foot. If a banded bird is ever found by an individual, the band can be sent to Washington, D.C., where the bird is tracked to its initial capture and all this information which is recorded on computer.
Biologists are able to piece together all kinds of information about where these birds are migrating to and how fast they're going. A bird that we have here in British Columbia, the Swainson's thrush, was one time brought into the American Embassy in Lima, Peru, and it was shot by an Indian in the rainforest by a blowgun. And so that bird was, I believe it was banded in the United States somewhere, and so there's a piece of information about Swainson's thrush that was gathered from an Indian who just happened to catch this bird and bring the band into someone who was interested in birds. Some of the records for migration and distance that have been found out from banding include things like a veery, which is another kind of thrush that we have in this part of British Columbia, was banded at a place called Long Point in Ontario. 2 days later, it was found in Florida. So it gives you a tremendous idea of how these birds are able to go very long distances in a very short period of time.
Not just anyone is allowed to capture and band birds, though. A special license and recommendation is required from the Canadian Wildlife Service to ensure the animals are being handled with due care and by experienced people. Although there are many wildlife projects in our provincial parks, the public isn't always aware of them. This past summer, though, an excellent opportunity took place at Tsutswap Provincial Park. A celebration of the 100th anniversary of wildlife conservation allowed families and visitors a day of entertainment and education regarding wildlife. Among the events to take place was an early morning nature hike.
So probably because of their demands.
Children also had a chance to test their knowledge on wildlife. A special trail with cleverly posted questions was set up, where boys and girls walked along, answering as many of them as they could.
Because it's mushrooms.
Perhaps the most entertaining event was this, though, a spectacle known as Moms and Cubs. Here the parents are lined up with their backs to their children. Along comes a grizzly bear, in this case one of the park naturalists, who steals a child away by reacting only to the sound of their cry. The parent must then run after their child and beat off the intruder with this blanket. Not the best line of defense, but it works.
What did you think of this game?
Oh, I thought it was a lot of fun, but quite difficult.
In what way? A lot of
recognizing your child's voice.
Did you recognize your child's voice?
I think so.
I thought it was quite good.
Did you recognize your child's voice?
Not offhand, no.
Does that surprise you?
Yes, it does. I thought I knew my daughter better than that.
Realizing what factors face our wildlife is just part of understanding the whole spectrum. What is also important is being aware of the steps we take to discover more about wildlife as a resource and why we engage in them.
I think it's important because really everyone thrills at the sight of animals in the wild, be it on the side of the road or off in a wilderness experience. And I think if we don't do it now, when it does come time that it needs to be done, it may be too late. And I think money spent on projects like this one and any other one in the province of British Columbia, or for that matter in Canada, are extremely important in the preservation of the wild animals that we have left. British Columbia is blessed with some of the most beautiful wildlife in the continent. There are a lot of people that care out there that we have grizzly bear and that we can see caribou and that we can see moose. And I hope that British Columbians are proud of what we have and that we won't allow them to go extinct. It's just that important.